Hello everybody, in this lecture I will be discussing with you about the use of coupling and bypass capacitor with the transistor amplifier. So let us start with the concept of coupling capacitor. We would like to see what it is and what is its use for the operation of transistor amplifier. So let us once again recall the discussion about the base biasing and the emitter biasing, the basic two biasing method that is called the prototype biasing method. Prototype means basic. So basic prototype biasing methods were base bias and emitter bias. We have discussed in our earlier classes. So let us for the time being consider for discussion about coupling capacitor, the base biased amplifier. Now, let us consider this diagram. An alternating voltage source is connected with a capacitor and resistor combination. So, here, since the impedance of the capacitor is inversely proportional to frequency, you know impedance of the capacitor, that is Xc, the reactance of the capacitor, that is 1 by j omega c, you know. So, it is Xc is inversely proportional to frequency omega, and omega means it is 2 pi f. So, that means it is inversely proportional to 1 by f. So you know this, that means what does it mean? As frequency will increase, the reactance will decrease. As frequency will decrease, reactance will increase. Now for DC, you know the frequency is zero. That means very low frequencies. So as frequency will decrease towards zero, reactance will increase. That means from this idea, we can say that the capacitor will effectively block a DC signal and will transmit the AC signal, because AC signal means as we go on increasing the frequency of AC, the reactance of the capacitor will drop. So when the frequency is high enough, the capacitive reactance will be much smaller than the resistance connected. So we can say if we go on increasing the frequency with respect to R, the reactance of C or the impedance posed by the presence of C in the circuit will become much smaller. In this case, almost all the AC source signal appearing across the resistor. So, for high frequencies, this capacitor will pass all the signals from the alternating source and it will be gone on to the resistor R. So, when used in this way, the capacitor, when used in this way, is called a coupling capacitor. That means it is coupling the AC alternating source with the load resistance R. That just connecting, coupling means connecting. So that's why it is called coupling capacitor, and it is helping the signal, the alternating signal, will to pass smoothly up to the load resistance R or the resistance R. So coupling capacitors are important because they allow us to couple an AC signal into an amplifier without disturbing its Q point. Now what is the advantage of using this coupling capacitor? This coupling capacitor, because of its property of source coupling to the immediately connected next part of the after the capacitor, that is the load or anything else, the transistor amplifier may be, it couples the AC signal, alternating signal, in such a way that the Q point of the transistor will not get disturbed. Now for a coupling capacitor to work properly, that its reactance must be much smaller than the resistance at the lowest frequency of the AC source. So suppose this coupling capacitor to work well, we need to devise a condition. The condition is the reactance of the capacitor must be smaller than the resistance at the lowest frequency of the AC source. That means as the frequency of the AC source will go on increasing at its lowest frequency, because at higher frequency it will be obvious that the capacitor will pass all the signal, but at the lowest frequency of the AC signal, if it is so designed, if it is so selected, the capacitor, that the passing of the signal will still become very easy, then at that point, at that lowest frequency of AC source, the reactance that is posed by the capacitor into the circuit, into the signal passage through it, will be very much smaller than the resistance. So this is the basic idea. Now, if we would like to consider how small it is, for good coupling, the condition is, for good coupling, the condition is capacitive reactance XC should be less than 10% of the value of the resistance, that is 0.1, less than 0.1 R. So this should be the condition. So in words, we can say the reactance should be at least 10 times smaller than the resistance at the lowest frequency of operation. This is at lowest AC signal frequency. This condition should be maintained at least, and at the higher frequency, we should be obviously maintained. So this is called the 10:1 rule for selecting a coupling capacitor in case of transistor amplifier. So this is called 10:1 rule. So now when this rule is satisfied, we can say that this circuit can be replaced by an equivalent circuit like this. The capacitor is being shorted. This is a short, and the resistor is connected to it. It is something like this. So this is the equivalent circuit for this 10:1 rule to be satisfied. Now, in this case, the magnitude of impedance, if it is denoted by Z, it should be root over R square plus XC square. Now, XC, at minimum, it is 0.1 R. That is, we can say R square plus 0.1 R whole square, applying the 10:1 rule. So from here you can calculate this is 1.01 R square, or it is 1.005 R. Now, if you compare this, the impedance should be within 1.005 R. That means it is within half of a percent of R at the lowest frequency. Then we can say that this circuit is only half a percent less than the current in this circuit. So the difference of the current conduction between these two circuits is only half a percent less. Only this much is the difference. So we can say that in this way, the considering this 10:1 rule, this capacitor will be acting as a short, and it will be called AC short. This, it will be posed as a short for AC signals only. So we can say about coupling capacitor that since DC voltage has a frequency of zero, the reactance of coupling capacitor is infinite at that frequency, and therefore they will block the capacitor, block the DC signal, because the capacitor will, in that case, for DC, it will act as open circuit. Capacitor, open circuit, and for AC, it will act as short circuit. So this will, this information is very much essential for DC and AC analysis purpose of transistor amplifier working with coupling capacitors. So unless otherwise stated, all circuits that will be analyzed by us will satisfy this 10:1 rule. So let us see with now an exam. Let us see the concept of coupling capacitor. Let us see this with an example. So consider this circuit of base biased amplifier. Suppose the load is 100K, the RC is 5 kilo ohm, VCC is 30 volt plus 30, and this is RB as 1 megohm. And here an alternating signal source of 100 microvolt is being applied, is connected, and that is connected via a coupling capacitor. So this is my coupling capacitor, which is coupling the source with the input of the transistor. So the values are given. So in this case, the DC base voltage, this is obviously 0.7 volt. You know this is VBE for a silicon transistor. Now because this 30 volt is much greater than this 0.7 volt, so we can say that the base current is approximately found by VCC, because here from this point, this whole thing is VCC. As compared to this VCC, this voltage is very less. So it is actually VCC divided by this base resistance will get you, will give you the base current. So it should be VCC divided by RB, that is 30 divided by 1 into 10 to the power 6, that means 30 microampere. Now if we consider beta DC as 100, so IC will be beta into IB, that is 100 into 30 into 10 to the power minus 6. So this is 3 milliampere. This is 3 milliampere. So we have found IC. Now let us find the collector voltage VC, voltage at this point, because from there the output is taken. So VC is now 30 volt minus 3 milliampere into RC, that is ICRC, VCC minus ICRC. This is the equation, 5 into 10 cube. So this should come as 15 volt. So the Q point, the location of Q point is at, the coordinate is VCEIC, that is 15, 3 milliampere, 15 volt, 3 milliampere. So this is the location of the Q point for this particular circuit because of this source coupling and other parameters. Now let us see the amplification by this circuit. So in the figure, we have just discussed about the basic connectivity of coupling capacitor. It has shown that how to add the components to build an amplifier from this figure. So first you need to add a coupling capacitor between an AC source and the base. This coupling capacitor is denoted by CC. Since this capacitor is open to direct current, the same DC base current exists with or without the capacitor and AC source. So I repeat, since the coupling capacitor will block the DC, the same DC base current, because IB calculated here is the DC base current, it will exist with or without the capacitor and the AC source. So similarly, a coupling capacitor may also be used between the collector and the load resistor. So if this is the load resistor, 100 kilo ohm, then we may connect another coupling capacitor here, and it is called, this is the source coupling capacitor, and it will be called load coupling capacitor. That means for smooth passage of the output from the transistor amplifier into the load, this capacitor is being used. So that it, this capacitor will also ensure that no DC unwanted DC component is passed on to the output, because we are here to amplify the AC signal. So our intention will be to couple at the input of the amplifier as much as AC as possible, and minimum DC or no DC, and also at the output we need to deliver all AC and no DC. So therefore this capacitor will help us in that regard. So this capacitor will also be open to the output capacitor, will also be open to DC, and DC collector, the DC collector voltage will be the same with or without the capacitor and the load resistor, because other because in any ways that will be blocked by DC to go into the load or to be appeared across the load. So the main idea is that the coupling capacitors will prevent the AC source and the load resistance from changing the Q point. So what we can say is that since we have isolated the whole DC operation from the load side and the source side, and we are keeping confined the whole DC operation within this area only, within the jurisdiction of transistor amplifier area only, within this region only. So no DC will be allowed to pass neither at the neither from the side of the source or neither to be delivered to the side of the load. So all DC will be confined inside this transistor amplifier area, and hence the Q point for this transistor amplifier area will be located at a fixed position. So we can say by the use of these two coupling capacitors, we are in a position to prevent the AC source and load resistance from changing the Q point of this transistor amplifier. So this is the key idea. Now, since the coupling capacitor is an AC short, all the AC source voltage will appear between the base and the ground, obviously. And this AC voltage produces an AC base current that is added to the existing IB. So this will be coupled through this capacitor, and the component of AC input signal will be added to the input current IB, which is DC. So at the input of the transistor amplifier, it will be a mixed of AC and DC base current. So we can say that the total base current will have a DC component and an AC component here at this point, at this area. So now, but that is going inside the transistor through the base terminal. Now, let us draw a DC waveform, DC and AC component waveform. Suppose this is a waveform of base current. You can see the alternating nature of base current, but it is 30 microamperes, but it has its DC value, which is also 30 microamperes. So IB, this is IB mixed up with the DC value and as well as the alternating nature. So this is the base current having both DC and AC component. This is the base current waveform. This is IB, and this side is T. So this is base current waveform. And the collector current from here can be calculated as 3 milliampere. So it will be a little larger than the base current. Once again, T, and this is IC. The average value or the DC value of collector current is 3 milliampere. So based on this DC value, there will be an alternating nature. The swing is large because of amplification by the transistor amplifier. So IB will be amplified to form the IC. So that the amplitude swing will be larger because of the amplification by the transistor base biased amplifier. So here we can see that the AC component is superimposed on the DC component at the input. So this is the input current and this is the output current. In the positive half cycle, you can see the AC base current adds 30 microampere to the DC base current, this much, and on the negative half cycle it is subtracted. That means it is natural because of the natural positive negative alteration nature of the sinusoidal signal. The AC base current produces an amplified version in collector current, and this is drawn over here because of the current gain of the transistor amplifier. And this collector current will also has a DC component, which is 3 milliampere. Superimposed on this is an AC component also. That's why this alternating nature has been shown. Now since this amplified collector current flows through the collector resistor, that means 5 kilo ohm here, it produces once again a varying voltage across the collector resistor. So across the collector resistor the voltage will also vary because of its alternating nature of IC. So when this voltage is subtracted from the supply voltage, that is VCC, we should get the collector voltage that should be VC, which should also be, this VC should also be of alternating nature, because an alternating voltage subtracted from a constant DC will be always giving an alternating waveform. So again, an AC component is superimposed on the DC component, we can say at the VC node with the voltage VC. The collector voltage is swinging sinusoidally above and below the DC level of 15 volt. Now we have calculated VC as 15 volt. So based on this 15 volt, we can draw the waveform of collector voltage VC. Based on this reference DC level, which is 15 volt, collector voltage will be of swinging nature. Okay. Now, this is something different. It will not be like this. How the VC will look like? It will be look like this. Now, there is an important point. This DC level is 15 volt for the collector voltage. But if this is my IC, so VC voltage waveform will be inverted of the current waveform. It is inverted replica of current waveform. That means we can say the AC collector voltage is inverted or 180 degree out of phase with the input voltage. 180 degree out of phase. 180 degree out of phase with input voltage. Now, how was the input voltage? It was like this one. So if you compare this waveform and this waveform, it is obviously 180 degree out of phase, because it is initially from starting from zero, it is going upwards. It is initially starting from zero, going downwards. So it is just the opposite or inverted. Now, why? The question is why this will be inverted? The collector voltage will be inverted. Now, let's have a closer look on the circuit and the waveforms. On the positive half cycle of the AC base current, that is this one, the positive half cycle, this area, you can see in the red, this positive half cycle of input base current waveform, the collector current increases. Why? Because of this equation. Because if IB increases positively, IC will increase positively in the positive direction. Now, then producing, it will produce, if IC is increased in positive direction, it will produce more voltage across the collector resistor. So larger voltage drop will be there across this collector resistor, that is 5 kilo ohm in this case. This means that there is less voltage between the collector and ground. So if there is a larger drop that is to be subtracted from the total VCC, that means the drop between the VC and the ground, that is VCE actually, that will become lesser. Okay. Similarly, on the negative half cycle, that means here of IB, the base current, the collector current decreases accordingly. Okay. So there will be less voltage across this collector resistor, less drop. So subtracting that from VCC will give us a high value of VC in that case. So the collector voltage VC will then increase. So what we can say, if IB increases positively, then IC increases positively, and therefore ICRC increases positively. But VC in that case decreases negatively. Okay, VC decreases negatively. On the contrary, if IB decreases negatively, IC decreases negatively, then ICRC decreases negatively, then VC increases positively. That means the variation of IB will be just the opposite to the variation of VC, or in other words, we can say that variation of collector voltage will be 180 degree out of phase with the variation of input current or voltage. So that's why the output waveform VC will be inverted to the input base current waveform or the input corresponding voltage waveform. Okay, so this is one most important idea about transistor amplifier, where we have seen that in common emitter mode, this transistor amplifier is specially working in common emitter mode. So especially in common emitter mode, while the transistor is amplifying, we are seeing that the output voltage waveform will be 180 degree out of phase or opposite, that means inverted to the input voltage waveform. So this is a very important concept for transistor, for working with transistor amplifiers. So now let us draw the different voltage waveforms on this circuit. So first we can draw from here, if this is this source is having a waveform like this, after it is going into the base terminal, it will be like this, added with IB, which is DC component, along with this AC signal source. The output at the input of the output coupling capacitor here, it should be inverted replica of this signal. That means it should be like this. So this is VC, the waveform of VC, and the voltage across the voltage waveform across the collector, that should be this one. So this is the output VO across the load resistance RL. So we can say that the AC source voltage is a small sinusoidal voltage. This is coupled into base while it is superimposed on the DC component of 0.7 volt, because this 0.7 volt will be added with this voltage. The variation in base voltage produces sinusoidal variation in base current and collector voltage. So the total collector voltage will be like this VC, which is an inverted sine wave superimposed with DC collector voltage, which is we have found 15 volt. So this will be superimposed with this. So collector voltage will be a combination of 15 volt DC and the inverted replica of the input signal, right? So the total collector voltage is this one. So now here notice that the output coupling capacitor, since it is open to direct current, that means it will block the DC component of the collector voltage and will short the alternating current, the AC component of collector voltage. So it will couple the AC collector voltage to the load resistor. So what is the difference between these two waveforms? This waveform VC will be still having some DC component inside it, but once this combination of DC and AC will be passing through this output coupling capacitor, at its output across the load resistance, only AC signal will be replicated. That means the DC part of the AC signal, DC part of the VC, that is the 15 volt signal, that will proportional to this 15 volt signal, that will be blocked by this output coupling capacitor. So this is why the load voltage will be a pure AC signal with an average value of zero. That means there will not be any DC voltage across this load resistance. So its average value will be zero. That means the difference between these two signals will be, this will be having average value DC value zero, but this is having DC value as 15 volt, which is this one we have calculated. So this is the difference between the two output quantity, output of the load and output of the output coupling capacitor. So the voltage gain of an amplifier is defined as, let us now find the voltage gain of this amplifier. The formula is AC output voltage divided by AC input voltage for this amplifier. AC output voltage divided by AC input voltage. So gain divided denoted by A, that is V out by V in, as per the definition. Now if you put different values, you can get different gains. So from here you can calculate the output voltage also, which is V out A into V in. So this is the formula for voltage gain of this amplifier, A equal to V out by V in. From here you can calculate the output voltage V out as A into V in. So this is the useful formula for calculating voltage gain or output voltage. Now if you want to calculate the input voltage, from here also it is V in equal to V out by A. You can calculate the input voltage as well. Now let us see the other type of capacitor that is used for the operation of transistor amplifier, and that is bypass capacitor. And for that bypass capacitor, we need to select the emitter biased amplifier. This is, and once again, the other prototype biasing amplifier, you know, because one prototype, one basic type is base bias amplifier, another basic type is prototype is basic or prototype amplifier is emitter biased amplifier. The problem with base bias amplifier, you have seen that it has unstable Q point. For this reason, it is not used very much as an amplifier. Instead, we use emitter biased amplifier either in voltage divider bias or in some other biasing technique with a stable Q point. So this is far more preferable prototype amplifier to be used for amplification purpose over and above the base bias amplifier because of stable Q point. It is having stable Q point, which is unlike with base biased amplifier. Unlike with base biased amplifier. Now a bypass capacitor is similar to coupling capacitor because in otherwise it is a capacitor and it appears open to direct current and shorted to alternating current, but it is not used to couple a signal between two points in this case. Instead, it is used to create an AC ground. A bypass capacitor will not, although its property of operation is same because of its capacitive action, but here this capacitor will not be used as a coupler between two signal points, but instead it is used to create an AC ground. AC ground creation, that is the important. That means AC ground creation means it will allow the signal to pass through the AC signal to pass through it smoothly so that it gets to reach the ground easily. Now you have already seen that an AC voltage source, the basic circuit which we have considered for coupling capacitor discussion. This is resistance R, capacitor C is here. Just modified the circuit a little bit, and you can see that the in the circuit the position of the R and C has been interchanged. So a AC voltage source is connected to a resistor with a capacitor here. Now when the frequency is high enough, the capacitive reactance is much smaller than the resistance. Okay, we have seen, and therefore in this case almost all the AC source voltage will appear across the resistor. In other words, we can say that if we mention this point as E, then this point is effectively shorted to ground because whole of the AC will be passed easily through this capacitor into the ground. So we can say this point E will be shorted to ground. That means the capacitor will act like an AC short. So this is equivalently can be drawn like this. And this point will be E, will be at AC ground. That means it is directly shorted to ground. Okay, so this is the equivalent of this circuit. So when used in this way, the capacitor is called a bypass capacitor. That means it is bypassing all the AC into the ground, making a particular node with which the capacitor is connected to stay at AC ground. Okay. So that's why it is called a bypass capacitor, because it is bypassing all the AC through it from a particular node into the ground. A bypass capacitor is important because it allows us to create an AC ground in an amplifier without disturbing its Q point. So it will be a very good application for stable Q point as well. That is for proper operation of transistor amplifier. So like we have seen for coupling capacitors, for bypass capacitors to work properly, its reactance must be much smaller than the resistance at the lowest frequency of the AC source, as we have seen in case of coupling capacitors also. For good bypassing, for good coupling, we have seen that it is 10 times of R, the capacitive reactance. Similarly, for good bypassing, the condition should be XC, the capacitive reactance should be less than 0.1 R, like we have seen in the coupling capacitors case. So once again, this will establish the 10:1 rule. So when once this rule is satisfied, we can say that this circuit will be replaced by this circuit, and capacitor will act as an AC short, or AC ground rather, we can say here, shorted to ground, AC shorted to ground. So now let us now draw a voltage divider amplifier. So now let us consider this voltage divider biased amplifier using the basic emitter biased current prototype. Here you can see that this is the voltage divider biasing circuit. You are now familiar with that. These are two coupling capacitors. This will couple the source into the circuit. VCC and RC is given, and this will couple the output to the load, this capacitor, output coupling capacitor. Now most important part is this area. This RE is connected with a parallel capacitor, which is called bypass capacitor here. This is actually the bypass capacitor. And if this all these values are being given, then from here, to calculate the DC voltages and current, we need to open this CC and CC. That means if we open circuit this one, so the source will be removed, and this load will be removed if we open this two capacitors, because naturally they will be acting as open circuit for calculating the DC voltages and current to find out the Q point for this particular amplifier. So as before, we have seen that we use a coupling capacitor between the source and the base here also. And another coupling capacitor between the collector and the load resistance is obviously shown. Now we also need to use a bypass capacitor between emitter and ground. This is the emitter terminal, you know, and if this emitter terminal is needed to be connected directly to ground, that means if this terminal or this node is required to be shorted to ground, we need to connect a capacitor which is called bypass capacitor between this terminal and ground. Without this capacitor, the AC base current would be much smaller, but with the bypass capacitor connected, we get a much larger voltage gain. And what is the advantage of this bypass capacitor? Much larger voltage gain. And if not connected, then IB will be less for absence of bypass capacitor. So another advantage of connecting the bypass capacitor, apart from getting the source, getting the alternating signal to provide a AC short circuit path into the ground, another thing is much larger voltage gain can be achieved by the use of bypass capacitor. And in the absence of bypass capacitor, IB will be less. So that's why if IB will be less, IC will be less, and accordingly output will be less. So voltage gain will be lesser. with the absence of bypass capacitor. The mathematical details of why this happens will be discussed later. Now this Vin, now after finding the DC operating point, let the source Vin, alternating source, is connected to this circuit. This is coupled into the base, the source, the input part of the circuit. Because of the bypass capacitor, all of this AC voltage appears across the base emitter diode. This AC voltage will be appearing here across the base emitter terminals. That means this is the base and this is the emitter. Between these two, the AC base current then produces an amplified AC collector voltage, as like previously we have seen in case of base bias circuits. Now how the waveforms will look like? The waveforms will be the AC source voltage is a small sinusoidal source voltage. You can see from here, first here there will be this type of voltage, then there will be another type here. At the output it will be inverted, and here at the across the load it will be like this. Now let us explain why these are coming like this, these waveforms. At the AC source voltage is a small sinusoidal voltage, which is this one, with an average value 0. So this is Vin initially, this is Vin at the input of the first coupling, input coupling capacitor, it is being applied. The base voltage is an AC voltage superimposed with a DC voltage, which is this one. It is superimposed with a DC base voltage, that is VB, this point voltage, because now this voltage will be added up with this voltage to give a superimposed AC plus DC voltage over here at the input of the transistor. The collector voltage is an amplified and inverted form of this AC voltage of a combination of DC and AC, and it will also be, the output will also be at the collector terminal, that is at VC, it will also be a combination of inverted AC voltage superimposed with DC collector voltage, which can be calculated. The DC collector voltage will be which can be calculated by keeping the input and output coupling capacitors open, the DC parameters, to fix up the Q point initially, to find the Q point rather initially. Now this will be also having then this coupling capacitor will stop the DC part of this VC voltage going into going across the load resistor RL, and load resistor RL will be giving an average value 0. There will not be any DC across the load resistor RL because of the presence of this output coupling capacitor. Now this is as usual the previous case. Now notice the special thing in this circuit. There is also a voltage on the emitter because of this resistance. There will be a voltage drop across this emitter. It is a pure DC voltage, obviously, as because we have initially calculated IC, and from there we can calculate IE, and if that IE is passed through this RE, there will be a DC voltage drop across this emitter resistance. There is no AC emitter voltage because emitter is at AC ground, and no AC will be found across this RE because of the presence of this parallel capacitor along with RE, and this capacitor will be always bypassing the AC component of any signal appearing at this node, that is VE, emitter voltage, into the ground because of its bypassing nature. So this is important to remember here, that it is very useful, this concept, for troubleshooting purpose. If the bypass capacitor were to open, an AC voltage would appear between the emitter and the ground. Now if this capacitor is made open, then obviously emitter, between the emitter terminal and ground, an AC voltage will be measured, could be measured. So this will immediately point us to the open bypass capacitor. That means if we find by measurement any AC voltage across this emitter terminal and ground, then it will indicate us that the bypass capacitor is kept open.